The North Face. It's one of the biggest clothing brands out there. It started in the US, but they now have an international presence. They specialize in making apparel and equipment for outdoor activities, most of them extreme. We're talking about mountain climbing and hiking and skiing, things where you may need some high quality products to stand up to some extreme temperatures. But if you're not avid in any of these activities, I imagine you know them for their high end coats and winter clothing. That's at least how I know them. Well, today, they're looking pretty successful. But there's been a lot of trouble along the way. In this video, I want to talk about this company's rise and fall and rise again, and fall again, and rise again. That's two falls, three rises, and reasons behind all of it. There's a lot to get to, but first, can I talk about this logo? I imagine if you're not involved in mountain climbing, you have no idea where this name comes from. Just sounds like random words put together. Well, the North Face is referring to the north face of a mountain, which is generally the hardest face to climb. See, the North Face generally receives less sunlight, which means while you're climbing it, it's going to be cooler, but it also means that the ice and the snow doesn't melt as much as the rest of the mountain, making it slippery and unpleasant on another level. On top of that, and I'm no expert here, but apparently over extended periods of time, the way the weather cycles interact with what's happening on the surface of the mountain leads to erosion that somehow causes the north side to have a steeper slope than the south side. I mean, this is common knowledge for anybody involved in mountain climbing. The name is meant to reflect the extreme nature of the company. If you're looking for the bigger challenge, the North Face is where you want to be. Don't even talk to me about that wimpy South Face. The other part of the logo, these curved lines on the right side, is also not obvious in its meaning. This is a visual representation of Half Dome, located in Yosemite National Park in California, not too far from San Francisco. It's a popular destination for more advanced hikers. According to the National Park Service, the 14 to 16 mile round trip hike to Half Dome is not for you if you're out of shape or unprepared. You will be gaining elevation for a total of 4,800 feet most of your way to the top of Half Dome. I think that further promotes the extreme nature of this company. The North Face dates back to 1965. It was a married couple named Doug and Susie Tompkins who were outdoor enthusiasts and decided to open a store in San Francisco that fit their passion. You see? San Francisco. The store targeted customers similar to themselves. It sold hiking and mountain climbing equipment. It was all higher end, and actually the exact thing that you would associate with the North Face today. The distinction is that they were purely a store at first. They didn't make any of their own products, which is a little strange to think about. The North Face is known for their groundbreaking products. After 3 years of existing as just a store, they started making some of their own backpacking equipment. In the early 70s, they expanded into clothing. In 1975 is when they had their first breakthrough product. The product was this geodesic dome tent, just a specific type of tent used for extreme conditions that soon became the industry standard. Then in 1979, they made this specific type of sleeping bag that became the standard. In 1988, they made this cold weather clothing system. I'm not going to name them all, but over the years, they've continued with these product innovations. And I think we can say that's a big part of their initial rise. When you're making something good that people want, and you're the first and only company to make it, people are going to buy it from you. The North Face continued to grow through the late 80s, and that's when they had their first major setback. They were confident in their products and understandably looking to grow. One of their methods of growing the business was to start manufacturing all of their own products. Instead of outsourcing it, they would do it, but it doesn't appear that they were too good at managing this. For one, it resulted in high costs that were hard to predict, but also, when you produce all of your own stuff, you really have to have an accurate idea of how much you're going to sell. The North Face had some trouble with this. They produced their products to a point where their supply far exceeded their demand, meaning they ended up with all of this extra inventory, which is bad, not only because all of their money was wrapped up into it, but because after a while, your inventory loses value, especially with clothing, but with most items, if you don't sell them quickly, they become out of date and not worth as much. And at that point, you're forced to write down the value of the inventory and maybe sell it at a lower price, which led to more issues for the North Face. See, this is a quality brand, right? If you go out and buy a new North Face coat, you expect to pay more than a lot of other brands. It has a certain reputation. They were left with all of this old inventory and couldn't justify selling it for full price, but they didn't want to throw it away either, so they set up these outlet stores where they sold all of it at reduced prices. It sounds logical, but this sort of thing doesn't work for quality brands like the North Face. It hurts their image. Seeing that logo on something no longer meant that the person paid top dollar for it, and they could have easily gotten it for cheap at an outlet store. And to add one more layer to this, instead of just selling their unsold inventory in these stores, they started producing lower priced products to sell there, which made things even worse. It's easy to see how all of this can have a negative effect on the company. In 1988, the North Face was acquired by a company called Odyssey Holdings right in the middle of all of this. Then in the early 90s, they put together a plan to try to turn all of this around. The plan involved a lot of undoing what they messed up before, mainly closing these outlet stores and relying more on outsourcing, along with trimming down their product lines and a few management changes. The changes helped restore the brand's image and bring sales back up, but then you wouldn't expect this. Right when all these changes started to take effect, the new owner, Odyssey Holdings, filed for bankruptcy. They actually owned about 30 other companies aside from the North Face, so there was a lot of factors here. In 1994, the North Face went to new owners and effectively became its own company once again. 1996 was a big year because a lot happened. For one, they became a public company. Also, they started opening what they called Summit Shops. They went really heavy into this too, opening 461 of them over the next 4 years. Summit Shops were essentially retail locations that were smaller and cheaper to operate than their traditional stores. They were intended to raise sales and improve brand awareness and showcase their new product lines. One of the new product lines that they wanted to showcase was techwear. Up until now, practically everything they sold was intended for mountain climbers or avid hikers, a very narrow customer base. Techwear was their first real attempt to attract a broader customer base with a more casual type of sportswear. And these all seem like smart enough moves, potentially risky, but we can see the reasoning behind all of it. It's hard to tell, but my perception is that a lot of this was successful, but not as successful as they had hoped. This is leading to their next fall, and this time it was big because they came really close to going out of business. There's a few factors, but the biggest reason behind it was an accounting scandal. At the end of the 90s, the North Face announced that they would go back in their financial statements from the past 2 years and correct some of the numbers. The new numbers for 1997 showed 6% lower sales and 42% lower profits. This is part of the report that was later released by the SEC. It says, during 1997 through 1998, the North Face's chief financial officer, Christopher Crawford, and sales vice president, Todd Katz, engaged in a series of schemes to artificially inflate the North Face's financial results. As a result, the North Face artificially inflated its revenue and gross margin recognition. Essentially, it found that the statements were inflated, and if you follow the stock market at all, you wouldn't be surprised to hear that the news caused their stock price to fall from $27 a share to $13, more than cutting its value in half. And then some of the core leaders of the company started resigning. This is bad stuff. It's the kind of stuff that could easily kill a company. Possibly their lowest point is reflected in this statement from their 1999 annual report, where it's essentially saying that it's unlikely they'll be able to continue. That's when you start weighing your options and considering bankruptcies, and who knows how that'll turn out. So if not for something big, there was a good chance the North Face would have ended right there. So the question is, how do they still exist today? And the answer is VF Corporation. VF Corporation is an absolute giant in the apparel industry. The year before, in 1999, they had over $5 billion in sales. Today they're approaching $12 billion. And that's because they're the owners of Vans, along with a bunch of other recognizable clothing brands, including the North Face. In April of 2000, they announced that they would buy the North Face for the ridiculously low price of $25.4 million. Which was only $2 a share. VF Corporation saw this as a cheap opportunity to add a strong brand to their collection that would help them reach new customers in that outdoor apparel segment. VF Corporation Corporation absolutely saved them. Being a multi-billion dollar company, they were able to put money toward the brand and allow it to grow. Today, it's grown to a point where it's their second largest brand behind only Vans, and really, how do you compete with Vans? I mean, it looks like these two were just a perfect match for each other. Instead of getting into the specifics of the past 20 years, think of the North Face as a stray dog. This adorable little guy was fighting to survive out there, and right when it was about to meet its end, a loving family in the form of VF Corporation took him in off the streets and started nurturing it. They made it healthy again and allowed it to grow over the years. They've helped each other through some tough times, and today their bond is stronger than ever. I like to think it's been very successful, and expanding the reach beyond the avid outdoors person has clearly found its way to the general population. You can buy it in department stores and sporting goods stores, and they have collaborations with Supreme. That's always good for your brand. I'm guessing that even the viewers that have never climbed or hiked in their life are pretty familiar with the North Face. Let me know in the comments, what do you think of all this? Do you agree with everything I said about their rise and fall and rise again and fall and rise? I would summarize this as a solid, innovative brand through most of its existence that was a little mismanaged at times, but despite some major setbacks, it's always been able to find its way back. And right now, it's under the protection of someone that's gotten it through the past 20 years without much trouble. Also, what do you think of the brand itself, as a consumer? A little pricey, but they seem to make good stuff. I don't think they would have existed this long if they didn't. So any thoughts about any of it, leave it in the comments. I'd like to hear what you have to say. Thank you for watching.